Good morning, everybody. Tammy, you just keep playing that. We're going to sing that chorus as we open up this morning, because we declare today that the Spirit of the Lord is with us today. Aren't you glad that God communes with us in that way through the Holy Spirit, that He walks with us, He talks with us? I sure enjoy, as Tammy plays, as we begin our time of worship on Wednesday, whether we're entering into the sanctuary or whether you're joining us by Facebook on Facebook Live. I know you hear this music playing, and just to hear this chorus just reminds me of God's presence with us always. So let's just sing this chorus together. It's not on the screens. This is not something that I had planned, but is just something that I just feel led for us to do. You know it. Sing with me. And He walks with me, and He talks with me, and He tells me I am His own, and the joy we share as we tarry there, none other have ever known. Well, that's the invitation that is placed before us today, is to come and fellowship with the Lord. Come and worship the Lord today. Well, here we are right in the middle of Easter week. Some traditionally are calling it Holy Week, and there have been a lot of programs on television. There have been a lot of worship services taking place all over our city, commemorating, remembering, worshiping, and celebrating the fact that we serve a risen Savior. As a matter of fact, I learned a long time ago that one of the traditional greetings on Easter Sunday morning or Easter week is to make the response or make the declaration, He is risen, and then the response is, He is risen indeed. That's right. So let me say that to you this morning, church. He is risen. Amen. You type that in where you are on Facebook joining us this morning, or on YouTube joining us a little later on in the day. We serve and celebrate a risen Savior. And oh, I am so thankful that you joining us here today. It's a little bit rainy outside. Those of you that were out there, y'all were coming in, shaking, I guess, your umbrella, and getting all the rain out of it. I saw you, some of you coming in and soothing that hair back, or maybe you were wiping that bald spot, whatever it was with the rain coming in and everything. And I pray that you there at home are dry in your living room, at your kitchen table, wherever that you are. But we're enduring a little bit of rain today. That seems to be just kind of the regular theme that keeps going on and on in our communities these past couple of weeks. And I pray that with the storms this past week and with potential storms today, that you and your home are safe. We're asking for God's protection over that. But there's one blessing that comes out of having this rain, and some of you will know what I'm talking about, but it washes the pollen away. You know, the older I get, I'm beginning to deal a little bit more with some of the pollen stuff. And bless Tammy's heart, she shared with me this morning that she's dealing fits. I don't want to embarrass you, Tammy, but she's over there playing the piano with a tissue in her hand. And just every once in a while, you'll see her wipe her nose there. But we all know what that's about, don't we, for the most part? So when the rain comes, it does wash that away. So we praise the Lord for that. Let me mention a couple of things going on in senior adult life here at GFBC. Don't have a lot to throw at you today. Just remember, Easter weekend is this weekend. I am excited about what God is going to do in our worship and through our worship as we gather in this place, as we gather in homes all over the city to celebrate the risen Savior. And we are excited that this weekend, beginning Saturday night with the Saturday night service at 6 o'clock, that our choir and orchestra are going to be joining us back here in the worship center for celebration. So we praise the Lord for that. So you pray for us as we meet tonight and do our run through. This will be the first time tonight that the choir and orchestra have been in the choir loft and on the stage in this place in over a year tonight when we gather together. So it's not just going to be a run through tonight. It's going to be a worship service. God is going to bless. And so you come on Saturday night as we all join together and worship the Lord and celebrate this Easter celebrations this weekend. Saturday night at 6 o'clock, and then again Sunday morning at 9 o'clock, and then again at 11. And all of the services are designed that they're going to be the same. You know, I tell you, I'm glad that we're not bound to an order of worship, and that if the Spirit moves and the Spirit leads, there's some changes that are made, or we do some things impromptu. But you're not going to miss something by choosing one of those nights to come or in the morning. But the important thing is that you come, bring a friend, bring a family member, come and celebrate. Invite someone to join you in your home. If you're not ready to meet back in person as well, please do that. And let's celebrate our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ and His resurrection. Now, along with this Sunday, there's not going to be any life groups that are meeting. It's just going to be our Easter worship services. So you make sure you make a note of that. I've got one other announcement I want to make. Rob Elliott gave me a sheet of paper this morning, so I don't have a screen for you today. And I'll try to do that next week if there's room. But he has put together a very, very quick trip with our the ministry that he heads up, with some of our traveling ministries and what he does through the recreation department there. And he is taking a group to the Ark Encounter that's up in Kentucky, I believe it is. I've never been there personally, but he's had quite a few folks say, why don't we go? Let's try to go. So very, very quickly, he has put that together to the Ark Encounter, and it's May the 5th through the 7th. May the 5th through the 7th. Here's what's going to be happening. You'll have the Ark Encounter, going to go to the Kentucky Horse Park, not the race course, but the horse park, the George Patton Museum, and Amish Country Market at the feed mill. All of this will be taking place up there and having a fun time together. Two-person occupancy. The total is $399 per person. That includes two nights lodging. It includes your motor coach transportation, all the admissions to all of the things that you're going to be doing, and four group meals. And it also includes the driver tip, the tip for the driver of the motor coach. Many of you know Roger, who has led some of these trips. Roger is going to be taking his bus, and he'll be there with you as well. So if you want to know more information about that, come see me afterwards. I've got some more information to it. Or call Rob Elliott at the Family Life Center. Talk with him. He'll put you on the list. He'll make arrangements for your deposit. But it's going to be a great trip. Don't miss that opportunity if you would like to do that. All right? Well, let's pray this morning and just begin our time of worship with our offering of praise through our prayer. And then as we sing, would you pray with me? Father, you are a good Father. Oh, and we love you. What a privilege it is to come into this place and to worship you today. You know, when it's not because we're coming into a building, but it's because we come into a gathering where folks all over this sanctuary have gathered. People on online medias are gathering, and we're uniting our hearts. We're focusing on you together as your church, as your people. We call it corporate worship, but it's the church worshiping their God. So, Father, this morning as we call out to you, as we sing unto you, as our hearts rejoice and praise you, Father, would you speak to our hearts this morning? Would you come and just be blessed? Choose from our praise like a gardener picks the fruit off of the tree and enjoy it. May it be pleasing unto you today. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Matthew chapter 28, beginning in verse 5, says this: "Do not be afraid." This is the angel speaking to the people that were standing their eyes wide open at an empty tomb. It says, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you seek Jesus who is crucified. He is not here, for he is risen. He said, 'Come and see the place where the Lord lay, and go quickly and tell his disciples that he is risen from the dead.'" Well, let's do that with our praise this morning. Christ the Lord is risen today. Come on, church, open your heart, sing unto the Lord. Christ the Lord is risen today. Alleluia. Sons of men and angels say, alleluia. Raise your voice and triumphs high, alleluia. Sing ye heaven and earth reply, alleluia. Lives again our glorious King, alleluia. Where, O death, is now thy sting? Alleluia. Dying once, he all doth save. Alleluia. Where thy victory, O grave? Redeeming work is done, alleluia. Fought the fight, the battle won, alleluia. Death in vain forbids him rise, alleluia. Christ has opened paradise, alleluia. Soar we now where Christ has led, alleluia. Following our exalted head, alleluia. Made like him we rise, alleluia. Ours the cross, the grave, the skies, alleluia. Hey, I appreciate you not bringing notice to the fact that I'd misspelled a word on that slide. You know, I'm only human, and I read it 5 different times, proofreading those things, Brother Mark, and I didn't notice it till right then. The word "following" was missing an L, so I'm sorry. I'll fix it for next time. Okay. Oh, Christ has arisen. He arose, church. Sing with me this song, would you? In the grave he lay, Jesus, my Savior, waiting the coming day, Jesus, my Lord. Up from the grave he arose, with a mighty triumph for his foes. He arose the victor of a dark domain, and he lives forever with his saints to reign. He arose, alleluia, Christ arose. Vainly they watch his bed, Jesus, my Savior, vainly.
dead. Jesus, my Lord. Up from the grave he arose with a mighty triumphal dispose. He arose the victor from the dark domain, and he lives forever with his saints to reign. He arose, he arose, hallelujah, Christ arose. Death cannot keep his prey. Jesus, my Savior, he tore the bars away. Jesus, my Lord. Up from the grave he arose with a mighty triumphal dispose. He arose, the victor of the dark domain, and he lives forever with his saints to reign. He arose, come on, church. He arose, hallelujah, Christ arose.
If you're joining us this morning online, just communicate with us. Type in there. Just type, just like we're singing here. He arose. He arose. Sing with me now as we continue in our worship, would you?
How lovely on the mountains are the feet of him who brings good news. Good news announcing peace, proclaiming news of happiness. Oh, our God reigns. Our God reigns. Our God reigns. Our God reigns. Yes, our God reigns. Our God reigns. Our God reigns. Our God reigns. Out of the tomb he came with grace and majesty. He is alive. He is alive. God loves us so. See here his hands, his feet, his side. Yes, we know he is alive.
Sing it, church.
Our God reigns. Our God reigns. Our God reigns. Our God reigns.
Sing it again.
Our God reigns. Our God reigns. Our God reigns. Our God reigns.
Let's sing that chorus one more time. And as we do, just make it an utterance of your praise unto him. Not so much a proclamation to those around you, but just speak at the feet of Jesus. You reign. Our God reigns. Our God reigns. He rose from the grave, victorious over death. and he reigns over death and all that it encompasses. The Bible says that the wages of sin is death. So he is Lord over death. He is Lord over sin. He is Lord over us if we give ourselves to him. Speak that to him this morning, would you? Just in your heart. Our God reigns. Our God reigns. Our God reigns. Our God reigns. As you entered in, you found your prayer guide there. I want you to take that out as we enter into a time of intercessory prayer. Folks watching online, as soon as we finish this, I will post immediately the prayer guide so you can tune into that, pull that off there, or you can go to the website right now, and that's where it is. Go to, on your church app if you want to, and on the bottom, pick resources, and you'll see there prayer guide, prayer and prayer guide. Just push that button and it'll come right up. Or you can tune to the website at www.gfbc.com. Go up at the top under ministries, choose prayer, circle down to the bottom there, prayer resources, click that and you'll see prayer guide. Click on that and it will open up. It's already been posted there. But let me mention a couple of things of some folks that were in and out of the hospital this week with some surgeries and things. I want to mention Steve Pennington, who had knee replacement surgery. Continue to pray for him as he recovers at home. There are others there, but let me mention Judy Sullivan. Judy had hernia surgeries, recovering at home. It's going to be a long recovery, very sore, so please pray for Judy. And Sandy Kicker, one of our office staff, one of our preschool teachers, just a very dear friend, been a part of this church for a long time. She's had back surgery, is recovering at home. I spoke with her this week, and she's a little sore from the surgery, but the pain that the surgery sought to relieve seems to be gone. So we praise the Lord for that. Upcoming procedures and things that are going on, April Travis will be starting infusions for cancer. Please be praying for that. Joe Griffin will have knee replacement on April the 7th at Brookwood. Jill Clark will have surgery on April the 5th. Kelly McNeil, the wife of our worship leader, Roy McNeil, is undergoing some scans today to check the results of her cancer treatment. She is having chest and abdomen and pelvic scans today, and May the 4th, she'll have scans on her brain and her spine. So be praying and asking for God's favor in that, that there will be no new lesions and that even those that are there will be reduced dramatically or gone. We are praying for history, for his victory in this situation. Pray for Brenda LaRue having eye surgery on the 7th, and Jerry Wilson will have a procedure for gallstone and a cyst in his kidney tomorrow. In St. Vincent's, the grandmother of Lauren Weeks. Lauren is a receptionist at the church office. She was taken to the ER yesterday, so please be praying for Miss Ruth Weeks. Let's be praying for her that God will just bless in that situation. She wasn't doing very well yesterday. Let me mention at UAB, the friend of Regina and Jeff Masters and one of my high school friends, Mike Ellsbury, we've been praying for a very long time. He has been in there with COVID for 86 days. At one point, the doctors told his precious wife, said, you just need to prepare for the worst. And as we continued to pray and people gathered around him and prayed over him, God began to take away that COVID one step at a time. And now he is going to be coming home, it looks like, on Good Friday. So praise the Lord for that. But continue to pray for Mike. It will be a very long recovery, even at home. He's been weakened quite a bit by the COVID and other issues. The niece of Nadine Wilson, Beth Crowell, will have surgery for ovarian cancer coming up very soon at UAB. So I constantly stay in touch with Miss Nadine and Mr. Aaron. And she asked me to add this to the list this week, and so we gladly do that. They are doing well, by the way, so we praise the Lord. And they very often watch us, and so we just want to say hello to you, Miss Nadine, Brother Aaron. We love you all so much and miss you. In out of town, let me mention also Marie McKay. Marie McKay was found unresponsive yesterday and taken to the hospital. We've not got an additional report today, so we pray that she is stable, and we'll try to find that out and get that information to you. But we all know Marie and Sam. Marie taught one of our ladies' life groups for many, many years. She was in charge of the church library, and Sam served here on staff as the minister of education. So we really, really want to pray with Miss Marie. Please do. The mother of Amy Barnett had part of her leg amputated and is not doing very well. And let's continue to also remember in Shepherd Center Rehab, one of our members, Clark Mason, praise the Lord, will be coming home soon. I saw a video this past week, and I think I shared this with you last week, saw a video of him standing with just a very little help. So that is a huge thing. So continue to pray for him, all right? Sympathies this week to the family of Vera Harris, one of our church members that went to be with the Lord, to Tim Busby in the loss of his father, and to Tim Bellamy in the loss of his mother, and Chris Bellamy in the loss of his grandmother. We want to pray for those. Please take this with you as you go and use this to pray. Look at it online and on our church website as you will. And because we are called to be prayer warriors, and folks entrust us with this information for us to intercede on their behalf. So let's do that for a couple of minutes right here during this time now. Would you join me in pray? Father, how we love you and just offer you our praise and our thanksgiving today, because you are good to us in so many ways. It's because of who you are. It's also because of what you do that we offer thanks. This morning, Father, there are many represented by so many names on our prayer guide, and many of our church members, those who are associated, family members, very dear friends of our church members, that have called upon us to agree together and to pray and to ask for healing, to ask for comfort, to ask for you to touch their lives. Father, would you do that this morning? The Bible tells us that by your stripes we are healed. And although I believe that talks more about our spiritual healing, I do believe, Father, that there's precedence that because you are Lord over sin, you're also Lord over sickness. So, Father, by those stripes we are healed today in Jesus' name. Father, I pray for those who are suffering from COVID and many other different diseases and things. Touch them. Make the diseases go away. Use the medications. Use the hands of the doctors, your tools. Father, touch those lives who are suffering today because of loss. Grief is very real, and it hurts so very deeply. There are many in this room that are still experiencing that loss, that grief in their own lives. Father, we just pray for your comfort over them. This morning, Father, we do acknowledge that without you, we're nothing, and it is you that has provided life for us, the very blood of Jesus. So, Father, as we worship you through the teaching of your word this morning, speak to our hearts very gently, but very sternly, that you are Lord, that you are King, that you are the God of healing. We pray this morning, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Amen. As we prepare our hearts for God's word this morning, I want us to sing one verse. then I'm going to share a song with you this morning. Would you sing with me this one verse? There is a fountain, church, and our healing, our joy flows from that fountain.
There is a fountain filled with blood drawn from Emmanuel's veins, and healers plunged beneath that flood lose all their guilty stains, lose all their guilty stains, lose all their guilty stains, and sinners plunged beneath that flood lose all their guilty stains.
Amen. Amen. Back it up a little bit there. It'll need to be backed up to the beginning. Thank you. All right.
The city was Jerusalem. The time was long ago. The people called him Jesus. His crime was the love that he showed. But I'm the one to blame. I caused him all his pain. He gave himself the day he wore my crown. He brought me love that only he could give. I brought him cause to cry. Even though he taught me how to live, I taught him how to die. But I'm the one to blame. I caused him all his pain. He gave himself the day he wore my crown. He could have called his holy father and said, take me away, please take me away. He could have said, I'm not guilty, and I'm not gonna stay. I'm not going to pay. But he walked right through that gate and then on up the hill. And as he fell beneath the weight, he cried, "Father, not my will, but I'm the one to blame. I caused him all his pain. He gave himself the day he won my crown. Oh, I'm the one to I caused you all your pain. You gave yourself the day. The day he wore our crown.
Amen. Brother Mark.
George, wow. Weren't you blessed by that this morning? Amen. Wow. Incredible time of worship. Thank you, buddy. Thank you, Tammy. Hang in there with all that pollen that's going on. Okay, and all the others that are here this morning, God bless you. Thank you for joining us this morning here in person. Came in through the rain, and, you know, kind of thought it was interesting, George, when you said that Rob is planning a trip to the Ark. We may need one right here, huh? You know, the Ark. But anyway, thank you for coming out in this stormy weather, and let's just pray that everybody's going to be safe and be okay as we walk through this series of storms. It just seems an unusual pattern, is it not? An unusual time with all the storms been going through our state recently and in the southeast. So you keep praying for those that are doing disaster relief recovery work as well down in the lower part of the down south of us, okay? And even in the Roebuck area, many other places. And I know Samaritan's Purse is there. John is here. He's a chaplain with Samaritan's Purse. And I think the guy's name is Clay there on site now with Samaritan's Purse. So you pray for that team as they're working, and we'll be contacting them. They're contacting us, and we're doing some things to help those folks in those areas. But, wow, when you think about today, as we come together this Wednesday before what we call Easter Sunday, Resurrection Sunday, this emphasis of the week, the Holy Week, it's called. And our focus is on the crucifixion and then on the resurrection. And many times today, I'll probably say this over and over, you know, it was a terrible Friday, was it not? It was a terrible Friday when you think about the crucifixion. No matter how you look at it, it was a terrible, terrible Friday. But then there was a triumphant Sunday. Amen? And sometimes you and I, in my life, your life, we may have some terrible Fridays. Isn't that true? We'll have some terrible Fridays. But some things that happen to us unexpectedly, uncertainty, just different things that we realize, man, we're going to have some terrible Fridays in our life. That's life. That's reality. But, man, you hold on because there's a triumphant Sunday coming in your life. And so we think about this and we think about Easter. You know, Easter's come once again. But let me just say this to you this morning. Not everyone is smiling about it. Okay? You got to get your mind around the world a little bit. And yes, there will be from the California coastline to the Florida coastline, from the Dakotas to Louisiana, there will be millions of people who will be worshiping in a special way, realizing what Easter Sunday is all about. But there's going to be billions of people around the world who do not care a thing about it, not one thing about it. Matter of fact, you think about it, it's a paradox of Easter. It's the holiest day on the Christian calendar, but not everybody shares the same joy that you and I share about the Triumphant Sunday this morning. Some people don't care. They absolutely don't care. You'll see that. They don't care that it's Easter Sunday. Not one iota do they care. Some others don't flat believe it. They just absolutely don't believe it. And then there's still others who don't know what to believe. So you got all these folks that they don't care, they don't believe, they don't know what to believe. And some are even very angry at the thought that we're celebrating Easter, at the thought of a man raising from the dead. It challenges everything they believe in. It challenges everything they think about the world. But yet, in the same tone, Easter reminds us in the biggest way possible that God plays by his own rules. And what I mean by that, on this day, on this Wednesday, as we get ready to go into Easter, we realize that God doesn't always do what we expect him to do. Isn't that right? He doesn't always do what we want him to do. Sometimes he does what we least expect him, and often he does things in ways that defy human understanding. Let me make that statement clear to you again. Often God, he will do things in a way that defies human understanding. The resurrection of the dead defies human understanding. We can't get our heads around that. Now, we believe it in the scriptures, but let me ask you something. Have you ever seen that happen? Have you ever seen someone raised from the dead? You know, raising the dead definitely falls in this category of defying human understanding. And so when we think about that, let's just go back to the disciples for a few moments on that resurrection Sunday. And I wonder how they felt on that Sunday morning. They know about the crucifixion. They know that their Savior, Jesus Christ, was nailed to the cross, that he was crucified on the cross. They know about that on Friday, that they took him down and they buried him. They were thinking that's what happened. Some of them didn't know exactly what happened. But get your mind around this thing. On that Sunday morning, when they found and they heard and some found that the stone had been rolled away and the tomb was empty, what do you think was going through their mind? What do you think was going through their mind? Just wonder with me for a few moments. I think of probably maybe two words that come to my mind that was going on in their mind. Probably scared to death. Scared to death. That's why they were hiding. You know, that's why they were hiding to begin with. They were scared to death. They're wondering, okay, who's going to be next? Who's going to be next? Scared. And maybe they even thought, man, this is strange. This is so odd. Because you got to realize, they did not immediately think that he's risen from the dead. That did not enter their mind immediately. When they ran to the stone, when they heard the stone was rolled away, and the two that ran, and immediately their mind didn't go, well, he's risen, he's risen. That didn't happen. That didn't happen immediately. You think about it. He's risen from the dead. It wasn't on their mind. They assumed the opposite. They assumed that someone had entered the tomb during the night and stolen his body. That was their assumption. That was their assumption. That somebody has rolled that stone away. Somebody went into the tomb. Somebody took his body out of there. And you think about it, you got to remember when Mary saw the empty tomb, she wept, and the angel said, she wept and told the angels, Mary, at the tomb that morning, saw the angels. You remember the scene. It's found in John's gospel, John chapter 20, verses 12 and following. Mary said, they have taken the Lord away, and we don't know where they put him. So immediately you say, well, they weren't expecting the resurrection. Some questions we got to ask ourselves this morning. The resurrection was the last thing on their mind that first Easter morning. And can I say this to you? Billions of people around the world today, the resurrection is the last thing on their mind this Sunday. The last thing on their mind. Eventually, the disciples began to believe. It didn't happen suddenly. For some, it took days, perhaps weeks, but soon the truth began to hit them. He's alive. You say when you realize what happened, eventually they begin to understand the truth and realize that he's alive. Because if you remember, you track the story of the Resurrection Sunday. First, they whispered the truth behind closed doors. He's alive. They went to the disciples who were behind closed doors, and they began whispering to one another, it's true. He's alive. And then all of a sudden, you keep reading the text, then you realize that the whisper behind closed doors, they begin to preach on the streets. They begin to go out into the streets and say, he's alive, he's alive, he's alive. We've seen him, he's alive. And finally, they took the message to the heart of the Roman Empire, he's alive, he's alive. Because you got to go, and you got to go back to a text in Scripture, and you got to remember that a few weeks after Easter, this is just a few weeks after Easter, Peter and John, they're on their way to the temple, and they met a crippled man. You remember that scene? Okay, you with me? This is just a few weeks after the resurrection. Again, they eventually began to understand what was taking place. They didn't immediately, but eventually they did. They whispered behind closed doors. They got out beside the closed doors and started talking on the streets. And now, here they come to the Roman Empire in Jerusalem, Peter and John. And they come up, they're walking to the temple, and a man's crippled. And they look at this man that is crippled, and Peter replied. And the man was asking for money, but Peter replied with those famous words. You know what he said? Silver and gold have I none. But what I do have, I give to you in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Walk. And in Acts 3, verse 6, the man stood up completely healed and began walking and leaping and praising God. And when the crowd had gathered, Peter preached the gospel in Acts 3, 11 through 26, challenging them to repent of their sins and to turn to Jesus Christ for salvation. Now, let me say this to you. Let me say that the rulers of the Jews heard about it, and they did not what? Like it. They did not like it. That's where we are. Acts chapter 4. That's where we are this morning in understanding the rising of the rejected stone. The rising of the rejected stone. The apostle began to preach, and they began preaching to the Roman Empire, proclaiming in Jesus the resurrection of the dead. And there's no doubt this really upset the leaders at that time. So let's look at it on the screens, if you will. Check this out with me. Acts chapter 4. Peter's preaching. The man's healed a few weeks after the resurrection. They finally got it. They finally understand the power of the resurrection. Then Peter, filled with what, church? The Holy Spirit. This is so exciting. Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, rulers of the people and the elders. There you go. The Pharisees, the Sadducees, the Roman government, everybody that's around him. If we are being examined today concerning a good deed done to a crippled man, by what means this man has been healed, let it be known to all of you. I love it. And to all the people of Israel, that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Now check this out, because here comes a zinger. Here it comes. By the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified. Wow. Do you think that kind of shocked them a little bit? You think that got a hold of their attention, got a hold of them just a little bit? That's kind of like hitting the pulpit, stomping your foot, clapping your hand. You crucified him. You crucified him. And then look, but don't you love this? Here comes the power of the resurrection. They finally realized it. It's being proclaimed around the world. Whom God raised from the dead, and the church says, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Whom raised him from the dead? God raised him from the dead. By him. By who? By Jesus Christ. By Jesus Christ. This man is standing before you well. Wow, what a statement. But then he's going to kind of clarify a couple of things to get them to really understand exactly what's taking place here. There's some strong statements. This Jesus that you crucified, guys, this Jesus is the stone by which the stone that was rejected by you, the builders, which has become the cornerstone. And then here's the statement. What a powerful statement. Here it comes. It shocks the world. And let me say something. It's still shocking the world. It's still shocking the world. And there is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven by which, given among men by which we must be saved. Wow. What a statement that Peter's making here. Because you got to understand, man, they were furious. The leaders, the rulers, the Sadducees, they were furious with this claim that Jesus himself had risen from the dead. Such a they were trying to stop this teaching. And this illustrates the point, even right here in this text. It illustrates the point that, man, people have always hated, and I know that's a strong word, but there are people who have always hated Easter Sunday morning. From back in Peter and John's day to our day, people have hated the Easter message. Why? It threatens their belief system. It threatens the very idea of someone being raised from the dead. And when we look at this, and the next day, you can read on the text if you want to. The next day, Peter and John, man, they brought them before the Sanhedrin, and they asked them this question, you know, by what power or what name did you do this? And it's a powerful question when the leaders ask Peter and John, by what name do you do this? By what authority do you have to do this? And with that question, by what authority, by what power, or by what name did you do this? It shocked the world. It shocked the world. It's a powerful question. And at that moment, the Christian movement began to take place. The Christian movement began to take place. You got to think about it. You got to think about it. It's a powerful question. And once this question was answered, once Peter and John said, it's by the name of Jesus, the one you crucified, that we've done this because God raised him from the dead. From that moment on, Christian persecution has invaded our world like never before. Christian persecution has invaded our world. You think about it. Millions of Christians have suffered and died for their faith. We know that on this very day in Muslim and Hindu countries, many Christians cannot worship freely or openly. We deal with it every day with missionaries calling into us, giving us some insights into the persecution in Muslim and Hindu countries. We also know that Christians are being put to death in Sudan and other countries with militant Muslims holding them hostage. We also know that there's an undisputed fact that during the years of communism, many believers spent years behind bars with nothing because of nothing more than preaching the gospel. Persecution happened. And when this took place, Peter had three choices to make. When this question was asked him, he had three choices to make. Choice number one, he could apologize for making trouble. Can I say something to you? There's no way he's going to do that, but he could have. Choice number two, he could say nothing and hope for the best. Plead the fifth. He's in court. He's in trial. He could have done that, but he didn't do that. Because I don't ever think Peter ever stopped from saying anything. But the third thing, he could seize the moment and preach the gospel. And that's what he did. That's what he did. So when we think about it, we get into this text for just a moment. I want to give you, in these five verses that we just read, Peter stands up with no apologies, no compromise, no hesitation, no apologies whatsoever. Even though it's a short sermon, he gives us five very powerful statements. Here's the first one that I'll bring to your attention. When he talks about who is this Jesus, when they asked him, what authority, by what name do you do this? He gives them a response that gives us three identifications of Jesus as we focus in on Easter Sunday. First of all, he tells them he is the rejected stone. He is the rejected stone. Peter answers the basic question. He answers in verse 10, who did this? He said, Jesus did. He could have stopped there, but he didn't. In verse 11, he continues on. He said, by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, God raised him from the dead. And then he says, by the way, you rejected him. You rejected him. You rejected him. He is the stone the builders rejected, and now he has become the capstone. In these two verses, Jesus, or Peter, Peter shares four things to the Jewish leaders that shocks them. You ready? Four things. Here it comes. You crucified him. Little truth. But God raised him from the dead. Also true. His power healed the lame man. Very true. You rejected God's Son of salvation. Also true. Matter of fact, this is a quote from Psalm 118, verse 22, the rejected stone becoming the capstone. The image here is in the ancient quarries that there would be a highly trained stone mason carefully would be built, would be over the construction project, and he was responsible for choosing the cornerstone. He was responsible for selecting the stone that would be the capstone, the cornerstone. And it would have to be the best stone out there. It would have to be the stone, the perfect stone for that building. The cornerstone had to be exactly right. There could be no other stone but this stone. And when that stone was placed in place, then that stone had to be exactly right, because if it wasn't exactly right, the entire building would be off. The entire building would be wrong. The entire building could crumble. And they would inspect the stones, and they would reject some, and they would keep the cornerstone. Reject some and keep the cornerstone. Those that were rejected may be used somewhere else in the building, but the cornerstone or the capstone, that's the one that was perfect. That's the one that they would build the building upon. And when Peter refers to that in this text, he's looking to them and saying, you rejected the very cornerstone of Jesus Christ, God's Son. Peter's saying, you rejected him, and God made him to be the cornerstone of salvation. In other words, when we look at it and you narrow it down a little bit more, think about this. He's saying to reject Jesus, you have rejected God's cornerstone, which also means, are you ready? Everybody say ready. Are you ready? Since it means this, since the cornerstone is the foundation, since the cornerstone is the foundation of salvation, since the cornerstone is the foundation of anything you build upon a wrong foundation, in itself would be wrong. Okay? The cornerstone is the right stone. It makes the building right. It makes the building strong. You rejected it. If you place anything else in its place, what would that do to the building? What would that do to your foundation? It would crumble. It would fall. It would not hold up. And Peter's saying to them, you rejected the cornerstone, and you've placed your religion in its place, and it's going to fall. It's going to fall. It won't hold up. Your religion won't hold up. And we're still doing that today. We're still doing that today. We find anything we can to put in place of Jesus Christ. We try to put anything we can put together in place of Jesus Christ. We lean on our politics. We lean on our possessions. We lean on our popularity. We may even lean on the church. We may lean on a pastor. We may be leaning on this. And we try to put anything else in its place but Jesus Christ. And let me say something to you. If you lean on anything else but Jesus Christ, your life will crumble. Your life will crumble. People will let you down. Places will let you down. Possessions will let you down, but Jesus Christ, the cornerstone, will never let you down. Can I get an amen? They rejected him. They rejected him. You know, years ago, 1998, how many of y'all were around in 1998? Anybody in Chicago in 1998? There was a seminar that went around in 1998 in Chicago, and that seminar was called the Jesus Seminar. You can look it up, the Jesus Seminar. Now, it was made up. It was made up of a lot of liberal theologians and liberal religious leaders, if I can use that word. And they would take the Word of God and debate over it and vote by using a red marble was good, black marble was bad. And they would choose what was being said about the truth, about the Word of God. And it came to the point where they were trying to debate the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. and by a vote, this is a Jesus seminar, are you with me? 1998, it wasn't that long ago, by a vote of 25 to 1, they declared that Jesus did not literally and physically raise from the dead. 25 to 1, 1998, religious leaders called the Jesus seminar. Wow. Then went on to make some comments about this resurrection. And bottom line, he was saying that when it comes to the resurrection, they just basically said that either Jesus was left on the cross, scavengers came, took him, or ate of him, if I can say that to you, or at best, some criminals came and took him to an unknown shallow grave and buried him. That's what happened to him. Can I say what that is? Can I tell you what that is? In 1998, in a Jesus seminar, that's the rejection of the resurrection. That's the rejection of the cornerstone. And it happens every day in our life. But Peter says to these leaders, you rejected the stone, but he also is the living stone. Gotta get an amen. He's the living stone. He's the living stone. Because when it says you rejected him, Peter simply said you rejected him, but God did what, church? Raise him from what? The dead. The living stone. The living stone. You crucified him, and you rejected him, but God raised him from the dead, and he became the living stone. He rose from the dead. And I can imagine, I know this with all my heart, that when Peter's addressing these folks, I mean, this is like you addressing, if you can, this is like you're addressing the most important people in the world, like, you know, the president or the or Congress or the cabinet, or whatever you want to say. This is a group of religious leaders. This is a group of leaders in the Roman Empire. And I can imagine, I believe Peter will never forget this moment. Matter of fact, I know he never forgot this moment because he wrote 1 Peter. Years later, he wrote 1 Peter. And look what the Bible says in 1 Peter chapter 2. I believe it's on the screens this morning. Here's the other text. Check it out. Here's Peter. Remember in Acts, he said, you rejected the stone, the cornerstone. But here it comes again. As you come to him, a living stone, he brings it right back up again. Rejected by men, but in the sight of God, chosen and precious. Chosen and precious. So Peter, again, identifying that he's the living stone. There's two images here. Jesus the stone and Jesus the source of life. You put those together, what have you got? The living stone. The living stone. I remember Billy Graham one time making this statement. How many of you remember Billy Graham? Anybody in here remember Billy Graham? Okay, but you know there's a lot of generations that are behind us that don't have a clue who Billy Graham is. Don't have a clue who he is. But aren't you thankful we had the opportunity to hear from him and to read his resources and be trained underneath his leadership? He made this statement. Billy Graham, he's often said, a dead Jesus cannot save anyone, but a living Christ can change your life. Hallelujah, huh? Check that out. Listen to what he said. A dead Jesus can't save anyone, but a living Christ can change your life. I'm here to say it to you this morning. Man, Jesus is alive and he is the living stone. Whether you reject him or don't, he is alive and he is the living stone. That's why I say to you today, on Friday it looked like the devil won, but on Sunday Jesus won the only battle that really matters. Life over death. On Friday, it was terrible, but it was triumphant on Sunday. I believe, and I wish I knew this song, George, but I just kind of remember a line or two from it. It was done by the Cathedrals. Anybody remember the Cathedrals? The Cathedrals? The song contains this line. I've read the end of the book, and we win. I just remember, I don't know, it just stuck in my mind. I read the end of the book and we win. A song by the Cathedral. Somebody may want to Google it up and listen to it. So what are you trying to say to us? Saying this, Easter teaches us that when the battle of the ages is over, the followers of Christ, we win. We win. There will be terrible Fridays, but there's going to be a triumphant Sunday. You know, and I'm about to land the plane, and, you know, it's raining outside, so you don't need to be in a real big hurry, do you? Check this out.
check this out. When because, you know, I'm sitting here thinking on this Easter, on this Wednesday before Easter, as you and I gathered here, man, we're going to celebrate. It, like George said earlier, it's going to be phenomenal worship services. I mean, it's going to be, there's going to be so much energy in this place with the choir and the orchestra back. I mean, come if you can. We want you to be here. We understand if you got to stay online because of the COVID. We understand that. But, man, you come. And let's be a part of a celebration like never before on Easter Sunday. But also remember that there's going to be millions of people that don't care about it at all. They don't care about it at all. And so when we think about it, I'm wondering if starting today, if maybe we should, just like our church right now, we're posting the 21 days of prayer. And I hope you're following along with the 21 days of prayer. We're posting those every day on our Facebook page, and we're trying to get the word out about our Easter celebration weekend. But I wonder if maybe the Christians who have the opportunity to post something on Facebook, instead of posting something about whatever doesn't matter, all of a sudden we start posting the fact that he is alive. What do you think? What would happen if we flooded Facebook, social media now, with the celebration of Easter? And you say, well, what do I put? Why don't you put something like this? This is why I believe in Easter. Can I give you some bullet points? This is why I believe in Easter. You say, why don't we believe in Easter? And if I were to ask you, why do you believe in Easter? What would you say? What would you say to someone if somebody, well, why are you believing in this Easter? Why are you showing up for Easter celebration? Why are you so excited about this Sunday being Resurrection Sunday? What is it in your heart and in your mind that's leading you to celebrate Easter Sunday? What would you say to them? Can I give you a few statements this morning? I would say something like this. I believe in the resurrection because the Word of God teaches it. I believe in the resurrection because God reveals truth to us. But I believe mainly because we can sense Christ living in my heart. Christ alive. Where? You say, where's he alive? In my heart. Can you say that this morning? That you believe in the resurrection because it's the Word of God says it, the Word of God reveals it to us, and Christ is alive in my heart. You see, listen, the resurrection is personally knowable. Knowable. You say, what do you mean? It changes not only our eternity, but it changes our daily lives. Because, yes, we celebrate it on Easter Sunday like never before, but every day Christ is alive in my heart. Because he, what? Lives. I can face what? Tomorrow. He is the living stone. And because he's the living stone, he's the cornerstone. He's the cornerstone. You rejected him. God raised him and made him the cornerstone. It's the cornerstone that holds our lives together. It's the cornerstone upon our lives are built. It's the cornerstone that keeps us strong in the storms. At the end of the sermon, Peter said, by no other cornerstone is there salvation. It's not Buddha, it's not Muhammad, it's not Confucius, it's not a pastor, it's not a priest, it's not a pope. It's not a church, it's not a denomination, it's not an organization. It's the cornerstone. And his name is Jesus. Is he this cornerstone of your life? Because Easter demands a choice. Easter demands a choice. Just like Peter said, you rejected him, but God raised him. So it's your choice this morning. Is he alive in your heart? Is he the cornerstone of your life? Will you bow your head and close your eyes with me and let me lead us in a prayer? As we wrap up this session this morning, getting ready for Easter. Man, I'm excited about it. I can't wait for it to come, be here. But in my mind, God keeps rattling my mind. But there's millions who have rejected me. There's millions who still don't know me. There's millions who hate Easter Sunday. There's millions who don't know what to believe. Maybe we can change that this Easter. Maybe it can just, but if it could just begin with one at a time, one person. And then that person changes someone. And that person, just like it was just Peter and John who stood before the Roman Empire. And the Christian movement began like a wildfire. But you got to make sure you know Christ as your cornerstone. You say, if you're online, you're watching us, and you say, I don't know, I'm not sure he's my cornerstone. Maybe this morning, right now, right in your room, in your living room, here in this room we call the worship center, you've never made Jesus Christ your cornerstone. You've put everything else in place, and you've realized that all of these everything else's have let you down, have fallen, have crumbled, because you don't have the cornerstone. That cornerstone has a name. God said, it's my son, Jesus, whom I raised from the dead. So if you've never given your heart and life to Jesus Christ, and he's never become your cornerstone, whisper this prayer in your heart so that you know that he's alive in your heart, and you can celebrate Easter every day of your life from this moment on. First of all, admit that you're a sinner. In your prayer, whisper this prayer. Say, dear Lord Jesus, I admit that I am a sinner and there is sin in my life. And as you pray to him, say this, Lord, please forgive me my sin, because I believe with all my heart that you died on a cross for me and you shed your blood for me so that I can have forgiveness of sin. And I beg you, please forgive me of all my sins. And come into my heart and save me, because I desperately need you. I've tried other things, other places, other events, and they have failed me. But by faith today, I ask you to come into my heart and to be the cornerstone of my life, the living Savior. Save me in Jesus' name. Now, with every head bowed and every eye closed, if you prayed that prayer, I know I'll be around here for a while. I know George will be around here for a while. If you're online and you prayed that prayer, will you type in Jesus? You type in Jesus, and we'll get back in touch with you about your next steps. But let me pray together now for us all. And let's celebrate together, knowing that someone has given their heart and life to Christ today. On this Wednesday before the Friday of crucifixion, because they're going to now celebrate the triumphant Sunday in a fresh new way. So, Father, thank you for being with us today. Thank you for teaching us your word through the life of Peter, revealing to us, yes, many reject you, but yes, you are the living stone, and yes, you are the cornerstone. So today we pull it all together and we say, thank you, Lord, for Easter Sunday, the resurrection of our Lord and Savior, who is the cornerstone of our life, not just on Easter Sunday, but every day of our life. Hold us together, Lord, until one day the battle of the ages is over and you call us home and we're with you for eternity. But until that day happens, give us the strength and the power and your presence and your peace to live for you, because you are now the cornerstone of our life. And I pray this in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen, amen. Thank you for being here this morning.
Amen.
George, come on. God bless you guys.
Thank you so much, Brother Mark. What a powerful message from God's Word right here in the middle of Easter week. Hey, Brother Mark, by the way, that old song by the Cathedral Quartet was called I've Read the Back of the Book. I've read the back of the book. All right. Well, amen. Hey, folks, as you leave today, I want to remind you, if you want to know more information about the Ark Encounter, May 5th and 7th, through 7th. If you'll come find me, I'll make sure to give you that information, if you will. But hey, do be careful as you're leaving. It is raining outside and as you travel as well, okay? Well, see you this weekend for our Easter celebration, and see you right back here next week for worship on Wednesday, all right? May the Lord bless you. May He keep you. May He make His face shine upon you. May He turn His face towards you and give you peace. God bless today. Bye-bye.
I've been reading in the Bible about the ending of the age. And one thing that's for certain, it grows closer every day. But I am not concerned about the way it's gonna end. 'Cause I've read the back of the book and we win.